Noah was really interested in the creative process, and that's something he talked about endlessly. There was a lot of talk that he was an outsider artist, but in fact he wasn't. He studied art at Chouinard, which later became CalArts. Because his work uses junk, people assume that that's an outsider, you know, because it isn't, doesn't have this kind of formal quality. There's a very formal quality to it, but there is this kind of unmade formalism to it.
There's so many textures going on and so many types of forms that it doesn't look like iconic land art statements. Though there are these major interests that so many of these artists, including Noah Purifoy, share, and those are how is nature affecting the process? How is erosion and light and shadow and heat affecting what you're doing in the land? But I do think it's interesting to note the differences, because there was this talk in the 60s with land artists of leaving this white cube system, and that was joined by a reality that many of these artists had financial support and were also exhibiting at galleries that were internationally known and respected. And that is a very different reality from Noah's reality.
My parents were sharecroppers. And by the time I was three, I was out in the field trying to help them pick cotton.
Noah was born in 1917. I'm not sure if people can imagine what that world was like for a black person, but it was, I'm sure it was challenging. And the odyssey of his life takes place like he's born in that situation, not in a wealthy family, and then goes on to go to college. And what he wanted to do is be a teacher. He studied history, but at that time they'd only let him teach shop. So right out of the gate, he's met with the confrontation of the American dream versus his reality and his view of the world.
After the war, he did degrees in social work and then made his way out to California.
Purifoy came here as a migrant, part of a huge swath of people trying to get away from the American Southeast and its history. So when I think about that space, I think about a greater sense of African retention because of its proximity. And so you don't have the same thing out here. It just doesn't exist.
He arrived in LA in 1951 and first was working as a social worker at a county hospital.
And he's working there for a while, and one day he just gets up and walks out because he knows that this isn't going to do anything either.
Then in 1964, he was offered the opportunity to step on as the founding director of the Watts Towers Art Center. And that was a really big turning point for him as an artist.
Not making objects, but bringing different kinds of people together really became his artwork.
So the Watts Towers Art Center's mission, in addition to working with the community, was to use found objects, because Simon Rodia had used found objects in this masterpiece of his. And then shortly after he stepped on there, there was this massive race rebellion in Watts. It became one of the most violent events of the 60s. There were numerous race rebellions at that moment in time, and of course we're living in a moment in time where this continues. So in the wake of August 1965, he went out into the streets of Watts, which really resembled Dresden. You know, it was completely bombed out, charred everything, and began collecting this burnt debris.
And I think at that point, when you're so actively involved in collecting that material, either whether it's from a riot or whether it's out here in the desert, you begin to have a different view of who you are and how you fit into the picture of the world. And that was Noah's way of responding to that.
That moment, Watts essentially, was really the catalyst for Noah as an artist. He decided that using found objects would be a sort of manifesto. And he and his colleague Judson Powell gathered together a group of six other artists and did this landmark undertaking, which they called 66 Signs of Neon, not only as a way to explore assemblage, but to also use these statements as a tool to talk about societal issues affecting not just Los Angeles, but the nation.
there are these reference points in Purifoy's work to Dadaism, to Surrealism, those artists who were working in the wake of World War I and working from an environment that could only be identified as having been destroyed. And I think Purifoy definitely comes from that place, amongst others. And then to think about how art is not just something to be looked at, which is also the other thrust of Purifoy's career, which forces the question of how can one be most effective?
I think that's really the basis of his activism, not necessarily going out and manning the barricades in the community, but trying to present things that might not be there so people could see outside of where they were.
Then in 1972, he left the art world. He was completely disenchanted by the early 70s with how little change had actually happened and how impoverished and still broken down life was in Watts. And he was offered the position as one of the founding members of the California Arts Council, which Governor Jerry Brown started in 1976.
And he's works with the Arts Council for about 10 years. And there's some kind of discussion about him not making art for 10 years, but I feel that it's at that point that his real conceptualism comes out, because he begins to develop programs, artists in schools, artists in communities, artists in prisons. And his work leaves the kind of the physical thing and becomes much more conceptual.
Many artists in the 60s took up social issues, but to feel convicted enough to devote every day of your life to trying to enact change.
He had this incredibly rich life that had different modes at different times. So there is that push-pull between the art and the activism. And I think that he brought those things together at different times in his life.
In 1987, though, he's getting older, and he decided he wanted to basically retire and to return to his studio practice, but wasn't able to make ends meet. He was living on Social Security, did not have the money to live in LA, did not have gallery representation, did not have someone bankrolling anything he was doing. And, you know, these are the realities of an artist who is trying to live, make work, and isn't supported by a major blue chip gallery, doesn't have financial backing, and he couldn't do it.
So he moves out here and then begins to develop these pieces. And that's how we get here. Noah believed that the desert was a partner with him in the creative process and whatever he was doing. I don't believe Noah was particularly interested in you knowing what he was thinking about. It was what your experience was with his work and how that made you, or what that made you think about, and how it made you look at yourself. That is what I believe he was into.
His practice changed when he moved to Joshua Tree. You know, in LA, trash was so plentiful. There was junk just piled, especially on the streets of Watts. And here, people recycle everything. And so he found himself for the first time going to swap meets and trying to strike up relationships with local businesses and neighbors, telling everyone, look, you know, I use everything, so if you have extra materials, bring them to me. And this is, you know, this is what he created. So all of these pieces, you know, speak to these experiences in oblique ways. You know, you look at them and they're aesthetic statements, and they're speaking about all these sorts of formal problems, but then there's these stories that lurk behind them. This piece that we're sitting in is called Shelter, and it relates to his experiences as a social worker and reflected on the experience of living in LA in the 80s during the Reagan administration, when so many people were kicked out of mental institutions and ended up on the streets of LA. He spoke about this piece as being a shelter for the homeless, a shelter for everyone.
You know, the idea is that we take these things and they all have a meaning to them, and once we place them in a different environment, the meaning changes. And that's where his interest lies. Well, why does that happen? And how do we put those things together? And that's what the creative process to him was solution. The creative process becomes a solution methodology.
Philosophy was something that really fueled him as an artist and as a person from the 50s through to his time out in Joshua Tree. And he never stopped talking about how fascinated he was by thinkers like Husserl and Heidegger and trying to explore phenomenology as a process and this idea of oneness with the world, something that he felt he was more in tune with when creating work, especially out here in the desert alone. Something that I like to point out to people when they're out here is that he was 72 when he moved out to the desert, and he had no assistants. And these days in the art world, I mean, every studio is full of a gazillion assistants. Nobody can make their own work because that's not what the machine demands. But he was out here doing this all by himself until 1999, when he had to use a wheelchair. And over the last 15 years of his life, he built this masterpiece.
Coming out here to the desert was perfect for him because it allowed him the freedom to work without the framework and consciousness of a commercial space. And ironically, you know, LACMA wasn't going to show his work back in the day. So, you know, he came out and made his own museum. That was his response to, oh, you want to show my stuff? Okay. I think it's important to realize that, let's say, like at the end of the Civil War, that ended 250 years of it being illegal to teach a black person how to read and write. And in a certain sense, we're not that much further away from that today. So why is Noah's work important? It's important because he really was the touchstone for a lot of other artists to feel safe enough to make their expression outside of what was thought of as being art. It's also important that institutions recognize people of color who are artists, and to really kind of insert them into the history, because they're not there.
So the fact that it wasn't all coming from galleries around the world, because he did not have that reception when he was living, it surprises some people. And I think that that surprise is partially why there has been, I think, a pretty great reception for the exhibition, is because a lot of people did not know the work.
You know, the Whitney just opened, and there's, if I'm not mistaken, about a third of the artists in the Whitney are artists of color. Now, 10 years ago, that wouldn't have happened. But it's about the recognition that it's all relevant and it's all important. That has not been the tone of our society, ever.